Okay, so very warm welcome, everybody. Indeed, very warm. I'm Shabnam. I'm from Siemens, and I do research for Siemens into embedded machine learning for large-scale cyber-physical systems. That's where my interest for TensorFlow comes from. And today, I want to thank, or we want to thank for Winden.de here hosting us and having taken care of the beverages and beer. Cole is going to tell us a bit more about Winden.de. We also have Suat here from Cape Analytics, who is going to, who helped us to get the pizza ready here. So thank you also. And also Altoros, I think they are the founding sponsors. But I think they are not here today. So that's why I jumped in for Natalia. So also a big thank you for Altoros, who made the OpenAI and TensorFlow meeting possible.
Okay, thank you, Shepard, for the introduction. So my name is Suat Kirikli, and I want to introduce Cape Analytics and tell you about what we are doing, who we are, and I think it's also interesting for deep learning guys because it's basically an application of deep learning that's already in a product. So, first of all, who we are. We are a startup based in Silicon Valley, in Palo Alto. And this year we opened an office in Munich, and as you can guess, we are hiring you too. Yes, we had like this year our second founding round, Series A, and had a big celebration in the Bay Area, where we flew over all the team from Munich 2. That was quite a nice trip. Let me tell you what we are doing. So as you can see here, we are basically extracting structured information from the built environment, from geo images, which includes like aerial imaging, satellite imaging, and drones. What does it mean? Unfortunately, you see only half of the... Here we go. So, there are like tons of money spent on basically getting these informations and also basically using that information. As you can see, like our target is like, for example, property insurance, maintenance planning, finding road holes, for example, and sending the team to a specific area of a road which might be worth to repair. Also like valuation of properties and real estate services and tax assessment. I took that picture over there for property insurance because it's basically a bad example. Since we are using satellite images, we would say perfect, the roof is in a perfect condition, everything is fine, because we don't see the rest of the house. But besides that, let's see. So we have, as an example, what are we expecting? This is an example from real estate and insurance. We are basically using deep learning to find houses, single family homes, figure out what kind of roof shape they have, covering material, the condition of the roof, the pitch, the area, or whether there is a pool with a diving board or a pool enclosure. Also like hazards, like overhanging trees. And then there is also important what kind of tree that is. A palm tree is not a problem if a branch falls on the roof, whereas for an oak tree or for a redwood tree, of course, that would damage the whole house. The same for additional structures on the parcel and so on. Another example, how we apply deep learning here. This is an example for segmentation, finding the houses. And we tried like computer vision approaches, combined approaches, and purely deep learning approaches. And as you can see, this is like the input image and the ground truth image. No surprise, we're using ground truth for test and training and validation. And this is an example. And that here is a result for a result from one of our segmentation modules, and you can see the numbers with the classical computer vision approaches, but with the deep learning approach, you have a precision recall above 97% for single-family homes. So structures that are small, like sheds or so, are not basically considered here. So we have our data will be pre-processed, so it will be available instantly. That's important for the customers we have. They want to have an instant quote if they want to insure a house or not, or whether they want to insure the house. That means we have to pre-process larger areas of interest. For that, we we're using Amazon Web Services. And with our interface here, it's like really easy, a one-click solution to start, in this case, 800 GPUs with a single click and run an AOI. We can run 24/7. We're using spot instances, which means if it's night in Ireland and nobody is using GPU instances, then it's cheaper to run it in Ireland rather than in North California or North Carolina or the other data centers. Another thing that was quite funny when we started the 800 GPU instances and spent a few thousand dollars in a few hours, Amazon immediately wrote us an email and basically wanted to make a deal with us. So this one is the global coverage. That's not the coverage we have yet. This is what you see here is the region of interest, like drawn as polygons, where there is like high resolution images available. And as you can see, of course, deserts, nobody takes pictures, aerial images on deserts. You might have satellite images, but all the like high populated areas, you have a lot of coverage. So that's it. Thank you for coming to this meetup, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to present for CAVE. And as a previous speaker, of course we are hiring. We want to double our team size. We are right now 9, 6 in Palo Alto, and 3 here in Munich. And these are only a few of the roles we are looking for. Especially machine learning, of course, and computer vision, which is concentrated here in Munich, but we are also looking for people who might want to move to Palo Alto or work there for a while. Besides that, we have tons of open positions which are not listed here, which means if you are more familiar with software engineering, DevOps, or AWS, feel free to talk to me. Thanks again, and I will hand over to Shebna. Enjoy your pizza.
Thank you. And, I will also very quickly hand over to Andreas, our first speaker from Norcom. Norcom is a company delivering solutions to automobile industry, and Andreas is doing time series clustering with deep learning using TensorFlow, and hopefully also deep learning does large models sometime in the future into autonomous driving cars, right? So,
alright, hello everybody, many thanks to the organizers for having this meeting here and for giving us the opportunity to talk to you. Can you hear me alright? Okay. So thanks for the kind introduction also. I'm Andreas Pavlik. I'm a data scientist working at Norcom. You've already heard that at Norcom we develop solutions, big data solutions for the automotive industry. And I will say a few more words about this in a second. First, I'd like to start with some background on myself. So before I came to Norcom, I worked as an astrophysicist. I got my PhD in Leiden University and then moved on for 2 postdocs at the University of Texas in Austin and at the Max Planck Institute for Astrophysics here in Garching, near Munich. And back then, as an astronomer, I was mostly interested in developing and running supercomputer simulations, namely of the formation of galaxies. So you see, my background is not in deep learning. I'm not a deep learning expert. I'm also not an expert in TensorFlow. But I think it still makes sense for me to stand here, because I think I have an interesting problem. Where I think also deep learning techniques could help solving it. And I would like to introduce this problem to you and hear your feedback. Just a few words about Mia and me working at Norcom, so let me spend a few words on it. And I promise this will be the only marketing slide that you will see in my talk tonight. So Nowcom is a medium-sized IT company with main offices here in Munich and also in Nuremberg. And in Munich, we focus on big data in the automotive industry. The automotive industry has a lot of interesting problems at the moment. There's a lot of exciting development going on. So there's autonomous driving, connected cars, and other things. And all these developments have one thing in common: they produce huge data. This data originates in test drives and during research and development. Now, this puts a real tough pressure on the automotive industry, these large volumes of data. And this is because their workflows and established tools have been developed quite some time ago, when data sizes were still relatively small. And now these data tools and workflows struggle to perform in today's data-rich regime. And so the automotive industry looks for big data solutions. And there's a couple of big data solutions available, but many of them have been developed for different purposes, for different industries, most notably perhaps in the internet industry. And so you can't just take these technologies and apply them in the automotive context, because there are other requirements. Right? They have the very specific set of requirements. And at Nowcom, we developed a big data automotive toolkit called Ascense, which helps our customers from the automotive industry to make this transition and adapt big data technologies more easily. And this platform, Ascense, integrates open source technologies like Hadoop and Spark and machine learning and wraps them up to meet enterprise and technical requirements of the automotive industry. And at Nowcom, we developed Ascense and we also apply it on the data. So yeah, if this sounds interesting to you, we are continuously looking for a new talent, please get in touch with us. Alright, so this is then the outline of my talk. I'm going to start with a brief introduction to type CS classification, where I also introduce our use case. And then I say a few words about deep learning and why TensorFlow is such a great tool to carry out deep learning. And then I apply deep learning to the classification of type CS. So how can we use deep learning in this context? I start with a review of some interesting ideas in the literature before I then apply these ideas in our use case. And I conclude with a brief summary. Alright, so time series are simply ordered sequences of events. And they're hard to avoid, you encounter them nearly everywhere. And so here I picked a few examples that I think are also very interesting from a classification point of view. And as an astrophysicist, one of my first thoughts was of light curves from variable stars or other cosmic objects. And here you see an example of an X-ray binary. This is a sketch of such a system, which is composed of two stars. They're rotating around each other, and one of these stars has already died and evolved into a black hole. And this black hole now accretes material from the companion star, and this leads to the ejection of a powerful jet. And we can see this jet, we can take light curves of it, and then what you find is a few distinct patterns in these light curves. And we now start classifying these patterns, then this is the first step in pinpointing the state in which the system is, and the first step in understanding the dynamics of the system. Another interesting example is measuring shapes of skulls, blood cells, butterflies. Many examples here come from biology. And this is shown here in this image. And you can measure shapes by taking a reference point and recording the distance to the edges of the object. And this leads to a time series-like sequence. And now you can compare objects by comparing their time series. And so you can find similar objects or very different objects. Right. So there are many other examples, like electrocardiograms in medicine, protein sequences in genetics, intruder activity logs in IT security, and of course sensor data in industry. So why would you do classification of time series? I mentioned already a few reasons. Generally, for the same reasons why you classify any object. Right? You want to index objects for fast search and retrieval. You want to detect anomalies, you want to discover novel behavior. And here's an example from the automotive industry. This is a problem we recently had and worked on, and this will serve as a use case I will go through here in this talk. This is about the following problem. So sometimes, for some cars, when you shift the gear, the car will respond with a brief buckling. And as a driver, you notice this physically, and as an automotive engineer, you see this as an anomaly in the evolution of the engine speed. And examples of this are shown here. And you see here the engine speed in normalized units as a function of time in normalized units. The blue curve shows a normal gear shift, where the engine speed simply goes up as you shift down. Right? There's just a little bit of noise superimposed. Now, the green dash curve shows a gear shift in which the car would buck. And so this is basically the same as the normal behavior, but with a distinct oscillation on top of it. And by the way, I'm showing artificial toy data here that I simulated, because I can't, I'm not allowed to show customer data here. So as an engineer, of course, you would like to remove this behavior. This is not a nice behavior. And what you do is you start into root cause analysis. And there, the beginning is that you try and separate the good from the bad and try to pinpoint the origin of the bad. And a challenge here is that these anomalies are quite rare. And it's good, but they're rare. And it's buried in terabytes of test data. And now we have the problem that I talked about before. Automotive tools are very specialized, can do very complex analysis, but many of them just cannot apply it at the moment out of the box on at the scale, on large data. It's just they can't perform the task. And so this is where our customers asked us to help with big data technologies. And in this case, we used Hadoop and Spark to extract individual gearshift events from a large data set of time series. And then we set out to use machine learning techniques to classify these individual events in good and bad. And now, when you classify time series, there are a couple of typical or classical conventional methods. And one of them is distance-based methods. And in these methods, you have a labeled training set. And you define a distance measure between time series. And now, for a given time series, which you would like to classify, you go in your training set, computer distances, and find the nearest neighbors. And then you decide the label based on the majority vote of the k nearest neighbors. Now, distances that are commonly used are Euclidean distance, and distance called dynamic time warping, which is a little bit more robust to distortions. And this is shown here as an example. You see again, the engine speed is a function of time, as I've shown earlier, and this just sketches how you would compute the Euclidean distance between your two time series. Now, the accuracy of these methods is usually very high. These methods are typically hard to beat in accuracy, but the downside is that they are computationally very expensive. And on the other hand, there are feature-based methods. There you extract characteristics of time series and feed them into classical machine learning algorithms like support vector machines or logistic regression. These are usually less expensive, but their accuracy depends highly on the quality of the features that you derive. And these features may be, for instance, distributional properties or spectral coefficients. And an example of such a feature is shown here. Right? So the labels are a bit small, but I'll tell you what it means. Here I have carried out the wavelet transform on the two time series I've showed earlier. And this gives me this matrix, which is called a spectrogram. And now each point in this matrix shows me on this axis what is the frequency, and on that axis, at which time this frequency was present and with which strength. This is indicated here by the color. Now, feature-based methods have one disadvantage. The features are very laborsome to derive. And the quality also depends highly on expert knowledge. And so this was the motivation for this talk. We wondered, like, can we come up with something like the feature-based method, but which avoids the construction, the manual construction of features, but still keeps the accuracy and also the speed of the methods. And this is where we looked into deep learning. Right? Deep learning promises us to learn features instead of handcraft. And you all know that there has been a deep learning revolution recently. Deep learning techniques are now very successfully applied in a wide variety of applications, covering speech recognition, natural language processing, and image classification. And we've just seen a very interesting talk on like, where this type of methods are applied. And now, This image here on the left shows a prototypical deep learning architecture. It's a multi-layer perceptron. This is a layered network of individual neurons. Neurons are fully connected with each other. And information now passes through this network in one direction, from the left to the right, from the input to the output. Each individual neuron imposes a non-linearity on the information that comes in which this lets this network learn very complex problems. And this network can have several hidden layers that you see here. And many hidden layers means this is a deep network. And that means it has this network has high capacity for abstracting problems, for generalizing problems. All right. And an area, perhaps one of the first, where this type of techniques was extremely successfully applied is image classification. And the success there is thanks mostly due to the construction of so-called convolutional neural networks. And because these will play a role in a talk later on, I will take a moment to introduce them briefly. Convolutional neural networks are basically biologically inspired variants of the multi-layer perceptron I've shown. And based on three building blocks, there's a local convolution element, there's shared weights, and there's subsampling. And this is kind of shown here. Local convolution means that each neuron in this network only sees a subset of the neurons from the previous layer. In a multilayer perceptron, neurons were fully connected. And this local convolution imposes a local filter on the input image. And this result is kind of how our visual cortex processes information. It's a hierarchical processing of subsets of the input. Shared weight means that these local filters are replicated across the entire input image in an identical manner. And this adds translational invariance to this algorithm. And finally, subsampling reduces the dimensionality of this problem and also adds robustness to the algorithm. And here's now a typical convolutional net that combines these elements, combines them by arranging them in many layers. And so you see there's an input image, and then there's a feature learning stage, and at the end of the stage, we have an output. These are the learned features that are then fed in a typical classification machinery, which is, for instance, a multi-layer perceptron. And this then assigns labels to these images, input images, based on the features that have been learned by the convolution. Okay, so there are many frameworks out there already that allow you to construct, train, and apply those methods. So why should you use TensorFlow? There's, for instance, also Derno, Torch, Café. I think I can't give you here a very general answer. I think this is something that you need to decide your own, address your own. But I can give you my opinion, all right? And I like TensorFlow for a couple of reasons. First, its interface is in Python. And I like this because it allows me to rapidly prototype and not switch between ideas. Second, I think that distributed computing in this context will be very important in the future, also across a large number of machines and different machines. And TensorFlow promises us to let us do this very efficiently, even if the compute architecture may be very heterogeneous. Third, it's from Google. You know, things move fast at Google, and so there's a high chance that this goes really big. And finally, it's similar to Theano. Theano is a very well-established deep learning framework, and this similarity has often been connotated as negatively. And people said TensorFlow doesn't add anything new, it's not normal. And that might be right, but doesn't need to be bad. Right? I think it's a plus that it's similar to Theano. Because Theano is a well-established framework, and so probably does something right. And to quote from the internet, Zachary Chase Lipton, he says, "You're right, Theano has been there forever, invented the genre, and in an automotive metaphor, it's the Ford Motors of compiling code for deep learning. But TensorFlow, even though it might not appear as novel, emerges now as something that resembles the Tesla Motors of the genre. Right? And who doesn't want to drive a Tesla?" Right, so how can we now use this, put this together to apply deep learning for time series classification? Okay, so the I would suggest first that it would make sense to look into convolutional nets for that. You know, there's many deep learning architectures. Convolutional nets seem interesting, and this is because timeshares share many similarities with images. So like images, they are often multi-scale, and they are often locally correlated. Moreover, features in the time series are often not fixed in time, right? They can shift around, there can be arbitrary phase shifts. And this is also similar to images. And so this suggested convolutional nets, which have been very successfully applied to image classification, could also be very successful for the classification of time series. Now there's one problem, obviously. Images are 2D objects, time series are 1D objects. So how do we feed in a time series and standard convolutional nets? And there's two answers to this that I can see. You can transform the time series into an image and feed it into a convolutional net. And you can feed it in raw, but then you need to adapt the convolutional net. At least you need to change the 2D convolutions from two 1D convolutions. And both of these approaches have their challenges. When you try and convert a time series into an image, then you like to make sure that this is a very general transformation that applies to a very wide range of number of classes of time series. And this is probably very hard. You can perhaps try the spectrogram I showed earlier, but I'm not sure if this will work very well for many classes of time series. For the second approach, the challenges are even more basic. Right? Will this work at all? And so when I looked into literature, I found two recent works that looked very interesting and that tried to address these points. And so I'd like to take you through these works now very briefly. The first one is Wang and Oates. Wang and Oates were inspired by the success of image classifiers and set out to propose a new method to transform time series into images, which you can then feed into convolutional nets as usual. And the transformation they suggest is shown here. I hope you can see it somewhat. On the left, there's a time series, and now follows a two-step procedure. First, in the first step, you transform this time series in polar coordinates. So what this means is that when you go from left to right in time, now you go from inside to outside in angular space. Okay? And when you here go up and down in amplitude, you now go left and right in angular space. And this is described by these equations. And now you have a second step where you take the angular coordinates and add them and subtract them and do a cosine or a sine transformation and yield a matrix. And this is shown here. And this is called the Gramian angular field. And these fields now you can feed into convolutional nets. Now there have been a couple of previous works that suggested ways of converting time series into images. And this work differs from these works in that this transformation is bijective. And that it preserves temporal dependencies. And Wang and Oates suggested this is critical for achieving high classification accuracies. Hewitt also looked into this problem, tried to apply convolutional neural nets to time series classification, but they took a very different approach. They fed in the time series as raw object. And this is the architecture they proposed. So here you see the time series, and then this is followed by a three-step process. This is transformation stage, a local convolution stage, and a full convolution stage. And in this first stage, the transformation stage, several transformations are applied to the time series. And this includes, for instance, an identity mapping, so you feed in the outgoing. It also includes smoothing and a downsampling operation. And each of these operations creates its own time series, which they call branches. And now it's fed into the local convolution stage. And it's called local because these branches are processed independently of each other. And at the end of this, so in this local convolution stage is basically a convolution net. And at the end of this, the output is concatenated into a single object, which is then fed into another convolution net. And this convolution net then eventually assigns labels, class labels to the time series. And Kurt, I suggest that this transformation stage, which is an add-on to classical standard convolutional nets, is critical for achieving high accuracies because it lets them deal with features like multi-scale nature and multi-frequency nature of the time series. But both works, right? perhaps not so surprising that their approaches work very well. And if you're interested in the exact results, I encourage you to look at the papers. You can find them on the archive. Specifically, you find that their methods compare really well with existing methods, that they are competitive or even better. And this is tested on a large number of test sets taken from this UCR time series benchmark set. So then, when I saw this, I got curious, would this also work that well in my case, like in the automotive problem? And so I tried it out. And so here, as a reminder, this was the problem. We had gear shifts, right, during which cars would sometimes buckle. And you would see this as an oscillation in the engine speed. And so I generated an artificial training set by producing many time series. There was a class one, a normal class, which was the normal behavior without oscillation. And I generated this simply by taking a logistic function, I varied the parameter of this function, and put on top some noise. And this is toy data, but it looks close to what we actually were looking at. There's a class two, and this is then the normal class. And here I did the same as for the normal class, but I added a small oscillation, a wavelet of random position, random strength, and random bit on top of it. And yeah, for this test, I assumed that these time series had like about like 100 time steps. And then this is a summary of the accuracies that I obtained with a number of approaches. So you see that the things I've tried out here. Obviously, I tried out the two deep learning architectures that I introduced. But I also tried out a couple of classical approaches just to provide a baseline for comparison. And I did this. I did the classification for a range of training sizes, starting from 100 training samples to 1,000 to 10,000. Now, the numbers here are errors. So it's not accuracy, it's classification errors. Accuracy would be 100 minus the errors, because this is in percent. And now, I started out with a classical distance-based k-nearest neighbors approach, and I found quite good results already, especially if you go to reasoning the size of the data set, of the training set, you obtain relatively low errors. Unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, these methods are very expensive, and so I couldn't run this on the largest training set in a reasonable time, and so I skipped it. Then I ran a classification using a logistic regression classifier, and here I had two variants. In one time, in one variant, I was feeding in the time series as raw object. You see, independent of the data set size, even for very large training sets, I got very poor results, like very high error rates. And then I accompanied this logistic regression classifier with a feature extraction stage, where I used the wavelet that I discussed before, and that did very well. So here I got really, I would say, excellent results, an error of about 1%. At the largest training set. And now, how did the deep learning architectures do? Well, they also did very well. You see this here. And of the two, the architecture that was feeding in the time series raw object did a bit better. It did even better than the wavelet approach that already was doing very well. But what really surprised me is that this deep learning approach did extremely well already with a very small data size, just 100 time series as a training set. So this was done quickly, so here a lot of stars. Basically, for some cases I couldn't get it to work. I need to figure out how this, and so I had to take some shortcuts to show you some intermediate results, so please be aware, don't take it with a grain of salt. Alright, so I think this looks very interesting and it's certainly worth pursuing.
What was the reason that you didn't manage to run on 100 sample set?
You mean this here? No, this means I used usually a time set of length 100, but for some reason the algorithm wouldn't let me do that. And I haven't figured out until now why this is. Okay. So I took a time set of length 200. So this is a different parameter. It's the length of the time series, the number of points I used to sample it. But I guess for this first evaluation, it wouldn't be too bad. Okay, then I'd like to summarize I've discussed time-series classification, which is a standard problem in data science, but remains challenging. Conventional methods that we've discussed are either computation expensive, these are the distance-based methods, or the accuracy depends strongly on the user, like on domain knowledge. These are the feature-based methods. And here, deep convolution nets are a promising alternative. They do not require us to handcraft features, yet they may still reach very high accuracies, perhaps even higher than with the conventional methods, and are still affordable from a computational point of view. Thank you.
Am I right that your problem definition is that you want to detect during a gear shift that the motor struggles and there is some anomalies, right?
Absolutely.
So the data you fed in is highly sequential. So I'm curious, why didn't you try to use a recurrent neural network to solve this problem, since this is like standard architecture to solve problems for sequential data?
Okay. Well, thanks for the comment. I think I have a good answer. I was just looking at what deep learning can do, you know, and I think the most, the lighthouse example for where deep learning methods were very successful is image classification. This is what you see in the internet, and so this is how I approach the problem, right? I kind of wanted to use convolutional nets because they do very well with classification of images. And then I kind of try to figure out how could this be done as time series. But you're right, there might be even better approaches, and I'm certainly going to look into this. Thanks.
Your data to begin with, do you always have it in the same window, like the same samples? Or was it like sometimes the driver didn't shift for 5 minutes? I don't get exactly these. Exact
time before
the shift
happens and afterwards, but that might also be a reason why going with this method, because the window is like always fixed. That's right. In this case, we had always the same fixed window and time. But and that might be a motivation to use this type of methods. But actually, the one, I didn't mention this, but this approach where you feed in a time series raw into these three stages of the convolutional neural net, you can also feed in time series of varying length. So this this can deal with it, and it produces these types of time series naturally also in the pipeline, because it does a downsampling, right, to account for the multi-scale nature of the time series. And this means it basically takes the full time series, but also just every second point, every fourth point, and so on, and feeds it in like that. So it's able to deal with that. And this is actually also an advantage of this over the classical conversion into an image and then feeding it into standard CNN.
Maybe one follow-up question. In your artificial test and training sample, do you mimic the displays between positive results?
In this case, when I applied the deep learning architecture, no. So in the so this was no, I didn't. Yeah. So I'm aware of this problem. I just haven't looked into it.
Another question: how long was the training size? Training time, well, time needed for training for the neural network that you...
It wasn't very long. So this is this was a relatively small problem. I took relatively small training sizes, and each of the samples was very short, like just 100 points, and it took like a couple of minutes on a normal CPU. Right? But normally we have, that's what you would use for training, and then you would apply it on big data and make this learned algorithm.
Yeah, so I'm a bit concerned about the pre-processing step. Can you just step back to the... Yeah. So how well this identity mapping, smoothing, and downsampling can capture the intrinsic irregularities or like the correlations within the time series? Because, well, you should tell me now. Because I guess that, for example, if you look at more like, for example, mutual information among the time series, isn't that more informative, for example, like entropy minimization or something like that to prepare data for the convolution network? Because just looking at the downsampling and smoothing, I don't know, by filtering you don't really get so much of intimate structure.
Well, it's a good point. I'm going to certainly look into this. You know, this is something I just adapted from the literature. It works very well for them, so that's why I got into it. It would be nice to better understand why it works so well. They give actually a little bit of intuition why it works so well also, like in the paper, so I encourage you to look at the paper. They show like how the filters look like, what's you know, not just what the input is, but how this input looks like when it got transformed through the layers. And it seems makes sense what I say. And I could imagine though that this downsampling is actually similar to something what you would call a Fourier transform, right? Where you try to capture the individual oscillations. It's probably very different, but I guess this is the idea behind it.
Did you consider autoencoders as a model, since they are really good for anomaly detection?
Yeah, that's great. That's how I wanted to start, but then I got sidetracked by these interesting papers. I think autoencoders would be like perhaps even more useful here, because I have two classes exactly. So it's actually an anomaly detection problem, right? And what you want to do in anomaly detection, you don't want to really separate things in two classes. Usually you know what's normal, but you don't know what's anormal. So you have an annotated set that says that's normal, but you don't have an annotated training set that says that's anormal, right? So you want to just learn based on normal examples, and then whenever something anormal comes in, you're detected. And so that's where autoencoders come into play. And that's certainly something we're going to try out.
Hey, then thank you. So I actually really like your view of single time series comparing it to signals you see in an image. Also, if you look at time series from dynamic systems, it really looks like moving images. So I kind of like the approach. So we're going to check your results. And up next is Micha, also from Norcom, also a data scientist, and he's looking into really scaling the deep learning or your tests on data clusters, data computing or server clusters or cloud computing probably. And actually that's also something really interesting. And I don't know if some of you realize that colleagues of mine were actually also hoping to contribute to tonight's talks by how we could also take those models and deploy them on embedded systems. So it goes into this direction. And then with that, I give it to you, Micha.
Thank you. Time to grab a beer. Or beverage of your choice. So, in the meantime, I might introduce myself. Micha Pilko, also working at Norcom as a data scientist. Although when it comes to this TensorFlow and distributed deep learning, I'm more into infrastructure almost, supporting scalable deep learning for our customers. We'll get there soon. First thing I want to say is that you might notice a certain discrepancy between my title and the general title of the event, Deep Dive into TensorFlow versus Intro to. I just want to make sure this is the intro to, right? So there's not going to be any deep dive, which basically means if you know a bit about the distributed versions of TensorFlow, or if you tried it out already, you might go and try to catch some sun still. There's not going to be anything really. Pardon the pun. Yeah, anyway, feel free to sort of disappear during the talk as well. Also, please do interrupt me if I'm saying either something stupid or you just want to ask something. That's also always going to work. You've seen this before. I'm not going to say much more about it. Andreas was good in presenting it. All I want to say is that for my part of the talk, I'm going to not focus so much on how we do the learning or how we at Norcom do stuff that Andreas was showing, but rather how we support other companies who do this, but want to do it in a really big data distributed, you know, they just have a lot of problems, or the problems are big, or the data is big, and we need to give them the infrastructure to support that. Cheers. Right. So with all those expectations hopefully lowered, let's go in. So I'm going to start with a quote, because I'm going to be referencing a lot of things a lot of time. And you've probably seen this one. Although given some laughs, I imagine you haven't, which is nice. So essentially it says that, you know, big data is something everybody's talking about, but not really so many people actually do it because they don't need to. Well, if that holds true for big data, or it's holding less and less true for big data, I could say deep learning is still on there, on the board. We have heard that there are companies who are doing it, right? So what? Not quite so many are doing it. And if you go a level higher, right, distributed deep learning, now that's just, you know, going crazy. And Suat was showing you, you're using a lot of GPUs, and I'm going to have some questions on that later, so please pay attention. There's not so many people doing that, or so many companies doing that, and there's a reason for it as well. Having said that, there are some who are, besides Google. For example, Yahoo is doing it. They don't use TensorFlow, they use something else. Here I'm just giving you just a quick view of how they describe their deep learning infrastructure. On the bottom right here, perhaps this thing will work for me as well. All right, where's the pointer? Is there?
It's on the top.
Never mind. Well, this is the infrastructure. So what they have is clusters where they have GPUs in there as well to do this deep learning. Thanks. What's interesting there is they connect those nodes. So nodes here are servers, imagine computer or server on a rack. They connect those specifically extra strongly with these InfiniBands as actually connections that let GPUs talk to each other a bit faster. Another speciality there at Yahoo is that they use the whole thing on Hadoop. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Hadoop. Who's worked with Hadoop? Can I have some hands up? Quite a lot of you. Who doesn't know what Hadoop is? It's going to be hard to lift your hands. Okay, Hadoop is very simply said an operating system for clusters. Obviously you can stone me for saying that, but essentially, that's how I understand it. It kind of has its own file system for clusters, and then it has its own set of applications you can use on top of that. And Spark is one of those, and what Yahoo did is they put Café on Spark. Café, I guess you would be familiar with if you're in TensorFlow. That's one of the older guys. So that's Yahoo. So people are doing it. Having said that, don't do it unless you have to. That's perhaps the first lesson. So ask yourself, do I really have to go with distributed deep learning? And quickly, something little that we did at Norcom is just quickly realize we don't always have to. So one thing you can do with TensorFlow is quite nice. And I don't know how many of you have tried that before, but you can retrain the existing model. So take pre-trained models and chop off the last layer and just train it on a new task. So although it was pre-trained on a completely different task, it will still work well on that. So who's ever done retraining with TensorFlow? Or without TensorFlow? All right, so not so many. I've kind of described it already. So you take the inception model that I hope you know. So that's kind of the most famous image net solving model coming out of Google, I think. And you chop off the last layer that kind of gives you the predictions or labels and so on. and you retrain that. So what you take from the initial inception model, you take this learned features that were learned using different tasks, but they still tend to work well for other problems as well, because images have underlying statistical structure that's kept over other stuff as well. So practically, if you go on a TensorFlow webpage or blog, I'm not sure how you call that, and then you say something like retrain models, you're gonna find a very simple couple of lines code where all you need to provide to this is folders with images, and the folders will have, each folder will have its own name, and that name will represent what the images within that folder are. And then you give this to this inception model, and then you know, you're gonna get your own super good classifier for whatever your problem is. And I mean, this is what we've tried quickly for L-Koenig recognition. I'm not native, so L-Koenig was something new to me, but in automotive industry, you describe those cars that are just look a bit strange because people don't want you to be able to properly assess how they look like. I don't know how much that works. There is certain reasons why companies might want to be able to automatically say, is there a car like this on the picture or not, or in the video or not? You can think of why that might be or not. So we've done just really quick proof of concept with taking three specific categories, saying, all right, is this a road, an empty road without cars? Is there a car on the road? So that was a road. Is there a car? Or is there an Erl Koenig in the picture? Using that inception pre-trained layer, 30 minutes on a CPU, really, really good accuracy. Actually, in this case, it was more like 99% accuracy because these things are quite distinct. So there was no problem in getting it. But essentially, don't do distributed deep learning if you don't have to.
Good question. Yeah? Did you do this as a binary learning problem, this one?
It was not binary. So we had three categories here.
So you could also do 10 or so?
Yeah, definitely. So, I mean, even out of the, they prepare the code for you in the sense that you just have to, they just give a number of folders in there, and they just look at the folder, they say, okay, there's 10 folders, that means I'll have 10 categories. So, super easy. I mean, a bit too easy, actually, because you don't get to see what's in there. It gets scary. Okay, let's say we figure out we need to do distributed deep learning, right? And let's first define what we mean by distributed deep learning. And this is where my question to Suad comes to. So first, let me quickly try to say what four ways of how you could distribute deep learning I could think of, right? One thing is you separate models and different data. Basically, you want to learn different models, and you have different data sets for learning those models. That's just this is essentially just saying, I want to do different things, and I can just use different computers for doing those different things. That's very straightforward, nothing. So that would be the top left one. Then if you go to the top bottom one, bottom left one, you can do training of different models on the same data, on the same task as well, right? So this would be perhaps good for trying to find your hyperparameters, ideal hyperparameters. You want to perhaps choose different type of models, different number of layers, different structure, and then you'll train them, and then you compare them, and you take your best one, or you do an ensemble of those as a final model, something like this, right? That kind of parallelization of training is still quite simple, right? You just copy your data on different places, and then you start training on those places. And where it becomes a bit more interesting or more difficult is when you start splitting things within the same model and the same data. And quite broadly, you can do this in two ways. You can split your data and do the data parallel learning. You do replicas of your model on different places, and you kind of start feeding it parts of the data and somehow synchronize those guys as you go along. I'll get more into the details of that. And then the other one is where you even split your model. So basically, your model is now all sitting on different GPUs or even different nodes or different servers. So those are the probably more complex ways. And I guess this is kind of my question here. Do you have to already use these things when you do the training?
No.
No, so you basically do something like that, right?
Basically, most of the time you use a single GPU. Best case scenario is like one of those large extensions on AWS, there are four of those. But with our my experience, those are even slower than a Titan X, a single Titan X.
Yeah.
But when I talked about 800 amp GPUs, then it was basically running the model. So it's not deep learning, let's call it deep prediction.
Right.
So it was like running the
right.
model.
So it's rather serving the model on the, you know, the huge data set that you guys have, right? Yeah, exactly. And so talking to other people who do this, we find that like over 80% of the cases of deep learning will fall into this type of parallelization, if any. But still, right, we're here to talk about distributed deep learning. Let's try to complicate it. Right, so a bit further now into those right models that we had before. So we had the data splitting or model splitting. A bit more into the detail, for example, for the why you would want to split the data and do this is because you want to train faster, essentially. And there are some, there's quite a lot of literature now that shows that this would work and that there would be some performance scaling benefits of doing this. And by doing this, I mean, again, you take a subset of your data shard, you train this one model with it, you take a mini batch, essentially, another one, and then you periodically synchronize those parameter values on of those models. By using a parameter server, which can either live on yet another node, or it can be even spread across different nodes, as we kind of see here. And then the other version, where you have model splitting. I mean, the reason why you want to do that is because you really want to have a huge model that doesn't fit anymore in your GPU memory or even your node memory, for example. It's kind of hard to justify those models at the moment. Having said that, looking at ImageNet, you know, it's getting the bigger models will be winning so far. So there might be some reason why you want to do that. Now, the issues with both of those approaches is efficiency, specifically efficiency of due to the communication, due to the I/O, right? So the reason why you use GPUs and you try to load everything on a single GPU, a Titan GPU, for example, is because you don't lose time in pushing the data or the parameters, so the model, up and down your communication I/O between the CPU memory or and then GPU memory and so on. So whereas this in the data parallel model is somehow lowered by saying, okay, I'm only going to synchronize every now and then. So it's this synchronization of the parameters that's expensive. In the model parallel setting, you even have to be communicating across the nodes for each activation of your nodes, each activation of your network neurons, or how you call them, and that can really slow you down in a sense. So this is the huge concern, and this is why Yahoo, if you remember the previous slide, was putting this NVIDIA bands across there.
Just to give an idea, in your previous example with the L-König, mm-hmm. How many nodes and how many layers do you use in the model, or is it invisible?
Who knows inception model? Can you answer this question then? So basically I used a pre-trained model that I was too lazy to read the paper on. do you know? Huh?
Don't remember right now.
Don't remember right now? I would say 15-ish, but it's really, I would have to look at it. But I took this original model, it's well described, it's quite commonly used and so on. Yeah. Having said that, I only trained the last layer, right? So the training we did was on the last layer, which basically meant like I was doing it up here in 30 minutes. All right, nothing distributed there. Right, another issue with communication, this is a bit of going out of TensorFlow, because TensorFlow doesn't quite support this, is imagine you have your training data that's really huge. So your training data might need to sit on different nodes. And that's how Hadoop works somehow. What it does is imagine it has a data set and it kind of replicates it and then shreds it over machines. So you imagine this is basically now being one server, second server, third server. Each of those will take a part of a data set and you will have some replication. So you see one here is also present here. Then if you run things on it, it runs Spark and Spark jobs on this. And you use Yarn, for example, as resource manager. That's somebody who's kind of telling which computer will do which part of work, training in our case, for example, that YARN will try to always put the jobs that need to be run on the same server that has the data. So it kind of matches the data and the computation, and that kind of tries to reduces the need to shuffle the data around. And that's part of the reasons why, for example, Café on Spark is running on YARN as well. But that's a bit of a sort of a going away from TensorFlow, because TensorFlow doesn't quite support it from what I know, and please again correct me if you know things differently. But yeah, that's just yet another thing about communication. All right, back to TensorFlow. It has a bit of a Google style ecosystem around, so when you go for the distributed gRPC, I don't know how many of you know this, it's generalized RPC, which stands for
remote procedure.
Yeah. Thank you. This is basically the procedures how the things communicate across nodes, yeah, across service. It's HTTP 2 based, using protobufs as a serialization format. So these guys are basically crucial for the distributed TensorFlow. That's kind of the basis of it. And then Kubernetes is a it's helpful for deployment. I noticed you have Docker on your t-shirt, so you'll probably be able to explain that better than I do. You can sort of manage your Docker images and then deploy things, which becomes, again, important in distributed settings, right? All of a sudden you have to send things around and jobs around. And then Bazel is just what they use for building stuff. All right, now let's finally go into the distributed Bazel. So, hello world. This code here essentially starts off a cluster of one server and does essentially nothing else but prints the hello world command as what you normally show. But it's already kind of introducing a couple of concepts that are important in this. I don't know how many of you can see this. Slides will probably be available later on. And the actual things are copies from Google TensorFlow blog on, or the tutorial on how to do distributed learning. So it's nothing you won't see if you want to try it. So essentially, yeah, the server is, something is associated to the task that you need to do in the graphs, and you kind of pin the sessions on those servers, or those servers are able to run the sessions, which are the ones that are managing the whole computation bit. So that's what we see in this example here, where we just sort of run one command. Now, if you want to go to more nodes, you don't want to create a cluster, you typically have to do this cluster specification, and you need to give it to each server. So each server you start, which is essentially each node that you start for work, needs to know the same, needs to have the same specification of how the cluster will look like. And this is how you kind of specify it, and how they kind of hierarchically describe the things that happen is they have jobs and they have tasks, or TensorFlow has jobs and have tasks, and then very typically jobs will be either worker, which is doing the computation in the training graph, and PC, which stands for parameter server, which will be holding the variables associated to the model. So here, for example, we do three worker jobs, tasks, and two PS tasks. And typically what we have, yeah, is one server per task. So what you want to do, for example, this would be running a data parallel training session where you have three models being trained in parallel and then exchanging their parameters and synchronizing the parameters using those other servers. And yeah, typically we'll have one server per task. Now, then you need to put operations on those devices. So operations and variables are parts of the computation graph of TensorFlow. I hope you have seen this thing before. If you haven't, tough luck. TensorFlow typically operates by you starting to define a computation graph, and then this computation graph gets executed within a certain session and so on. So what we do here is we give a part of that computation graph to different devices. Yeah? And those devices here are essentially linked to those servers that we had. So this is, again, just a sort of a pseudocode they can, no, not pseudocode, it's an actual code, but yeah, that's how we would do it. Another great thing, I think, that's specifically useful for distributed deep learning is the supervisor, which is a wrapper over yet three other classes. So the whole TensorFlow object class system is a bit much. That's partly why I was saying that you know, don't go distributed if you don't need to. But this supervisor is a wrapper over a coordinator, a saver, and a session manager, which kind of have names that give you already an idea what they do, right? So we'll do variable initialization as a part of session managing, checkpointing, summarizing things to a log that you can display with TensorFlow dashboards, automatic initialization. If you failed at some point, it will go from the leftist checkpoint. And in the case where we have distributed learning and we have several nodes, several workers, it will also define a chief worker. That's one specific worker that is sort of handling the session. And the other ones are kind of waiting for. This is how it looks like within the code. Again, a lot of it is missed, so this ain't gonna run by itself. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, first, you know, there could be only one chief, and you can define it whatever, however you want to. It's one of those tasks that's gonna be the chief. And yeah, what else do we see? This manage session there essentially starts and initializes all the variables. Yeah, and just starts running things. I'm sorry that this is a bit dry, but don't really know how to do it differently. Right, now if we skip out now a bit to, again, we're at the data parallel learning, but we're not looking at code anymore, we're thinking about it, principles in general. So we're talking about in data parallel learning that the different models need to kind of synchronize as they go along, or their parameters have to be synchronized every now and then. And you can do this in two different ways, and that's where kind of TensorFlow distributed shines from what I've seen in other frameworks, distributed frameworks, is that it allows for the asynchronous data parallelism, where you don't need to wait for each of the models to finish with their mini batch and then synchronize all of them, but you can kind of incrementally synchronize as the things are flowing in. And there are reasons why you would want to do this asynchronously. Obviously, the main reason being that it's going to go faster, you don't need to wait, so you don't have this idle time on your GPUs, especially if your system is heterogeneous, that's important. But it introduces yet another variability in your training system, so you know there's a bit of a trade-off there, and you have to see when it works and when it doesn't. But the general idea is, yeah, either you wait for all of them and synchronously update, or you kind of have them incrementally updating each other. And that's, again, this is now two ways. There's other ways how you could do this. So I just recently heard about a way where you kind of have your models in a circular fashion, and you don't have a common truth across all of them, but you kind of update via neighbors. So you kind of always look at your neighbors, you try to be on the same level with your neighbors, and everybody's doing that, and this kind of reduces the amount of communication that needs to happen, which kind of speeds things up again. And what they report that with this method they can get a scaling factor of 1 over n, square root of n, which basically means, you know, four GPUs, half the time. Yeah, 9 GPUs, 1/3 of the training time. Which is already quite good for the other stuff that we've seen, among others this one. So Altoros is not here today? No? This is good. So I can shamelessly steal their performance study. Well, I do put the link out there, so if you want to see, there's more to it than what I put here, but they try TensorFlow distributed a bit to try to see how it scales. And what you see here is, so they have a number of nodes, so node would be now a server that has several GPUs, and they now vary the number of nodes and number of GPUs. The number of GPUs would be different colors, the number of nodes would be going from left to right on the slide, and what you measure is how fast you are, essentially, right? How many samples you can process per second in total. So for all the nodes, all the GPUs. And you can see, you know, that it keeps getting better. But if you were to actually look at, you know, going from red to yellow is going from 2 to 4 GPUs, right? It's 2 times the amount of GPUs you put in, but you go at least at the 5-node level, you go from, you know, 45 to 50 perhaps. So it's quite incremental, the progress that you get there. So I think it goes along to what Suad was saying before, that this distributed things don't always bring a huge speed up. All right, I'm kind of sorry I couldn't do much. I was initially planning to have this as a short part of our common talk with Andreas, so to kind of make up for that, I put together a list of things we did not talk about, along with the links where you can educate yourself if you want to look into it. First one, on, like putting everything together, I've kind of briefly sketched a couple of pieces of that constitute the distributed TensorFlow, but we still need to put it together. And there's a couple of people have done that, put that on a GitHub. Google obviously did that as well, although slightly slightly awkwardly still, so it's not so super easy to run it compared to the other thing that I was talking about, the retraining. We didn't talk about a concept of in-graph replication versus between-graph replication. It's partly because I thought it was too much and partly because I don't understand it well enough to really say anything about it. Specifically, I don't understand why one is better than the other. We didn't talk about specific hardware components. Obviously, GPUs are supported of the batch, and I would imagine they internally support other stuff as well, given their TPUs that they have. So you can imagine that can be extended quite nicely. We didn't talk about model splitting much because, well, I really haven't seen a case where we really need that yet. And yeah, at the bottom I include another link to another media presentation that was talking about the same thing as I did and probably did a bit better. But yeah, there you go. Sure, I got a question. So what do you mean by kinds of parameters? Is that, are you talking about like sort of hyperparameters?
Specific, the parallelism that you try, I presume it's a problem specific. So if it is, does that affect the kinds of parallelism that you try to learn the parameters that you try to find?
I would imagine it does. I don't have personally enough experience to comment further on that. One other thing beyond the actual problem that you want to solve and how you would want to do the parallelism, so beyond the actual problem, it's probably also your hardware infrastructure. So as we mentioned before, the communication between devices is quite important. So for the speed of training, so you might want to adopt your model both to the problem as well as your underlying infrastructure for training. I don't know if that's any answer, but I would imagine you would do it differently for different projects, obviously. But I can't say exactly how.
Just wondering, it might seem naive, but when you train a model in parallel, do you end up with a slightly different model?
You can. So definitely using your data parallel way of doing things will give you additional variability on your ending model, and especially if you do things asynchronously. If you do things synchronously, I guess you could, in principle, guarantee to have at least the same variability that you would, even if you do it in the same system, but you used same random seeds, for example.
You see if anyone's like benchmarked and compared the accuracies or versus performance time? Is it degradation or maybe even sometimes improvement?
I definitely will have looked at that, right? And most of the most of what I remember is that with asynchronous, for example, you can still get to better accuracy within time. Having said that, when Google does benchmarks, they say we don't care about how much resources we need. So that's in its paper. A couple of things were from the paper, the original TensorFlow paper, I think before the TensorFlow was out there, so I was still disbelief or so, where they talk about distributed learning. And there, yeah, they do performance matrices, but not taking into account how much GPUs they actually use. So that's just Google. And I'm sure there's others who did that, but I can't comment on that. No.
I have a question regarding the retraining of models. As I understand it, you just retrain the classification layer. So the feature extraction is just imported from another training session.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So is there anything regarding the data I feed in to this model regarding image size or
in that case they're always going to be rescaled into a specific form, whatever you had. I think it includes cropping and scaling.
So I got to rescale my data set for the trained.
I think it does it for you. I think it even does it for you, so you don't have to do it yourself. But I'm not completely sure. I think I have done some reprocessing. It's been a while since I did it.
Another question, will this also work for data with what is embedded in a bigger picture, let's say like traffic sign recognition? So I train it on a set of traffic signs, and I have a picture of a street where there's a traffic sign visible. Will this be recognized?
I would imagine it would. But so wait, in the end you would want to put in already the snippets of your images, or you would want to put the full image and just...
I want to train it on images of traffic signs, and then I want to feed in an image of a street where there is a traffic sign visible, and I want to have classification on that.
Probably worse than what would be if you already feed them with signs on the image. But you know, there is some inverse... I mean, in that case I would try to... I don't know is the proper answer, but I'm just now kind of trying to brainstorm what I would try to do. So there is some scale. I mean, there's some scaling variance in convolutional neural networks, and in inception is one of those. So I would imagine you get some of it at least out of the bag. But if you want to improve that, then I would perhaps try to rescale things and, you know, rescale your original training images. I would start with just trying it out, and I would think it would do rather well, but. One more.
How well TensorFlow compares to other libraries in terms of GPU scaling or scaling for distributed systems?
For what I read, it's not all that good on the single GPU levels. But for me, the good thing about TensorFlow is it's kind of a bit more of a mature product compared to some other libraries that are faster but are more, you know, developed in research environments where people really know how to use them. And you know, for TensorFlow, they kind of give you some things out of the bag. You know, the dashboard is super nice. The model serving module of TensorFlow is super nice, and so on. So that's where I think is why we would be betting on TensorFlow as well, because you know this how fast it is, how fast it's not. I think it's going to improve, especially with the amount of community that TensorFlow is attracting.
So if you have some cameras and Theano, so you think it's worthwhile switching to TensorFlow? What is the difference? You know, if you look at cameras, for example, if you use it with Theano or
If you are a small department that, you know, a bunch of like really smart PhDs that want to do things as efficiently as possible, then go for whatever works the fastest, which I wouldn't know what it is, but there are, I think, and you, Andreas, actually looked at some point at some performance matrices, which one would be the fastest. But if you are thinking about more sort of commercial setting where you either going to have a bigger team or you're going to have a lot of people coming in, going out, you're going to have to serve the models quite easily. I mean, if you start thinking about those things, then I would think more about TensorFlow than the other ones. Yeah, in mind. And having said that, we talk about Café on Spark, and this is also another one which, where TensorFlow is now a bit behind in a sense, because you know, this Spark and Hadoop, they're kind of getting into these big clusters. I showed you who Baidu has the same thing. So basically Baidu also put something on Spark. I don't know exactly what. Berkeley, the ones who did Café, they had their own version and so on. And a lot of people putting these things on Spark, essentially for the reasons that you want to have all your machine learning big data things at the same place and managed from the same place. Especially for these really big, huge corporations that are working on that. So those are also going to be probably interesting.
But you need a cluster for that, right?
Yeah.
Or you have a cluster, you actually need a cluster. Did you try out actually the TensorFlow running on Google's computers?
On Google's computers, no.
So the cloud-based version?
No. So yeah, we didn't. So typically our clients tend to like their own clusters because their data.
So. You don't see a chance for that to scale also for industry, that the industrial...
Oh no, I definitely think a lot of industry is going to go to cloud, yeah. Because, but we are specifically working in a very data protective environment, so...
Yeah,
no, definitely I think it's going to go in clouds.
One more philosophical question, Ryan. So, neural networks appear because we wanted to accelerate computation. They are intrinsically parallel and we love them because they are similar to the brain and so on. Then, right now, we have neural networks, huge neural networks, and we need to create infrastructure for that to accelerate computation. But how about turning back to biology and looking at spiking neural networks? Because right now, infrastructure, you told us about bottlenecks in communication, synchronous communication and so on. But well, guess what? Our brain doesn't have any supervisor, yeah? There's no clock signal there to synchronize all the neurons. Spiking neural networks are coming really, really fast on the field. Is your work still motivated with the infrastructure? Because we'll be able to run spike networks in GPUs, CPUs, or even custom microcontrollers. So you can tell me that.
Spinnaker.
Well, if you talk about that, but I didn't want to bring it because people maybe not know it.
So you so much hit my topic. So I did a PhD in computational neuroscience, essentially on spiking networks. So we can take this offline and yeah.
This
I love you for this comment, but yeah. I did an internship specifically looking in using spiking neural networks for machine learning so that we can reduce the power consumptions and computation.
And you're defending the other side, right?
I'm not defending any sides, you know, I'm just following the money.
I thought you really sell this thing, you know?
Oh, thank you.
I see.
I gotta give you the number of my boss, too.
Okay, we don't have to talk about.
But can you give some for people who don't know at all what spiking neural networks are?
Oh, spiking neural networks? So, all these networks, they have little nodes, we call them neurons, because, well, brain's neurons. And what's always propagating through is those activities of those neurons. And they are a number, and that they change from one step to another. You put a new image, you're going to get a new number. Well, the brains, those numbers in the brains are, in one approximation, the frequencies of spikes. So neurons will transmit discrete signals, so just basically going on and off, on, and so on. And this is how they communicate, and that's essentially kind of a cheap communication as well. Plus, it encodes time in there, which we don't have here so much. And there's a lot. I think there's a lot of promise in that, but we haven't quite cracked it yet. And I think that also hardware-wise, like Spinnaker and what's that other project?
Tunort right now from IBM.
Oh right.
Tunort,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
So it's like yeah. You're the
top. Go ahead, please. I mean, I think it's a community thing.
So right now there's hardware which mimics the structure of the brain right now. It's dedicated for that kind of processing. So right now you don't think about CPUs and GPUs anymore. We have custom hardware which implements neurons. And you can do computation with neurons. So you can just put all these networks which will run natively on the hardware, which is a new trend right now in this area. So you can accelerate via commodity hardware, which is GPUs these days, or custom hardware. So you choose your flavor right now. But that way it's harder to program. This is something that everyone has available, and we have all these amazing tools these days, like TensorFlow and all the others, which can help us prototype fast and so on. But that's another wave coming right now. So we have to be aware of that.
Thank you.
Since the topic just slipped to spike neural networks, is there such a thing as a library in TensorFlow for spiking neural networks or liquid state machines or something like that?
Not that I would know. Probably not. Brian
Nest. I can give you some names for
like. Yeah, we can have a little spiking table later. I'm super happy to talk about it.
Okay. We have that topic covered. there was one more question. Did we miss you? Do you want?
What other methods of data augmentation that you did in this course? Besides cropping and scaling?
Oh, I didn't do anything really. I mean, that was really just, it was throwing things in, and I might have done the I have to look at my code. I might have done the pre-processing to just scale to make sure that it's the right size, but that was it. Okay. Bearson.
Are we done? Do you want to go out, right?
Yeah, I mean, we can still take it offline. I don't think everybody's interested in this.
Okay, then thank you very much. Also big thank you to everyone coming here. This is really a cool meetup, I think, even we're dedicated people to learn more and exchange more. And also please just take the time and exchange all of these ideas. I know I'm going to join that conversation. So I think we can stay a little bit more here. Can we also go outside? Okay, so we can. So cool. Thank you very much for Aline, Paul and the others from Mindanao. It was really cool you having us here. Thanks.